Welcome back. We'll continue with the Goh Cheng Leong. Today we'll be covering the chapter 23. Now, when we were talking about the climate regions, we have already covered all these regions. We are moving towards with the Siberian region today, and we would be left with just two, that is Laurentian and the polar climate. Now, this Siberian, as you can see, lies between the steppes and the Arctic areas. So the southern boundary touches with the steppes, and the northern boundary or the polar boundary of the Siberian climate touches towards the Arctic climate. Now if you look onto the map closely, you would have whole of the North America above 60 degree latitude that would be having the coniferous or the Siberian type of climate. Now this Siberian type of climate, the most interesting part is this region towards the region of Siberia, as you can see, would be known as Taiga, and that would be the name only for the European region. So the name varies as you move. Now on this map, if I locate, this would be the range of the continental Siberian climate. Now again, this range lies towards the North Hemisphere, but if we move on to the North Hemisphere, there is nearly absence of the Siberian climate that is seen. That is attributed primarily to two reasons. First is, there is lack of the big landmass that could be seen as in the Northern Hemisphere. The secondly is the strong oceanic influence, and because of that you have the Siberian climate effect that is diluted, and therefore the southern hemisphere you won't find the extreme or the exact Siberian type climate as in the northern hemispheres. Again, the common vegetation that is seen is conifers. Now conifers, it's important you should not get confused. There are two things, altitude and latitude. So what we are talking right now is the latitudinal dimension, another is the altitudinal dimension. Now conifers are found at both the regions. As you move higher on the mountain ranges, you would see conifers as well. However, if you move higher in the latitude, you would see conifers as well. However, in South Hemisphere, conifers are found only in the mountain uplands. As you move altitudinally in the regions of South China, New Zealand, Tasmania and Southeast Australia. Now coming on to the climate, climate is mainly winters, which are long and cold. However, summers are very small and brief. Spring and autumn are like of transition seasons that could be seen. Now the isotherm is 50 degree Fahrenheit for the warmest month from the polewards as you move, and the winter months you have temperature that goes below the freezing point, that is minus 0 degree Celsius. So you have temperature in negative that could be seen. Now due to the extreme of the temperatures that is seen in the pole, in this coniferous belt, we call it as the cold pole of the north. Now this is a direct question which could be asked as an MCQ in most of the exams. So it is also known as the cold pole of the earth. Again, the North American region has lesser extremity of the temperature because the east-west extent is less. However, if you move on to the European region, the Siberian region, the temperature ranges are more as a result, due to the fact that the east-west extremity is more or the landmass is more. So that's one of the major reasons what is the difference between the North American and the European type of continental Siberian climate. The lowest temperature has been recorded in this zone, and that goes to around minus 90 degree Fahrenheit at Verkhoyansky. The region is known for heavy snowfall. Now what happens is an interesting phenomena. You have frost in the month of August and September. Now most of the rivers of this region are primarily snow covered. You have snow there for more than 150 days or so, and then only for few days you have the snow that melts into water. The rivers which are further north, like Volga River, you have 150 days it is ice covered. If you move further north, you have Ob, Lena and Yenisei. These are covered for ice for nearly 210 days. There are very strong winds that blow in this region. They are known as blizzards in Canada and Buran in Europe, and they are up to a speed of 50 miles per hour. So it's a kind of very fast speed of winds that could be seen. Again, because of this fast speed, what happens is you have snowfall that is occurring, and these snowflakes occur in the lower latitudes, lower atmosphere, sorry. As a result, the visibility is reduced in this region. Most of these areas are sparsely populated. The regions which are sparsely populated are known as non-ecumene. So that's another term that you must be familiar with. So you have two classifications, ecumene and non-ecumene. The region which is sparsely populated is known as non-ecumene. If we come on to the rainfall is usually 15 to 25 inches. The rainfall is distributed throughout the years. We cannot say there is only one month where you would have the rainfall. Now the reason for the rainfall, however, varies. In the summers, you have maximum rainfall due to the conventional rainfall, and the interior of the region gets heated, because of which you have the summer rainfalls. In winter, you have snowfall when your temperature goes below the freezing point. Now, the vegetation in this region is very specific. You must have heard or known of Christmas trees, and those are kind of conifers, and most of the conifers are seen in this belt. Now, conifers are unique because of few things. First of all, they have needle shaped leaves. As a result, their requirement for transpiration is very less, and they are well adapted to a region with even low precipitation. They require very less moisture. So low temperature, low evaporation and high relative humidity along with a small precipitation is one of the key areas where you can have the coniferous growth. Now what are the factors that affect the rainfall in this region? First is the height, the next is the latitude, then the distance from the polar areas, the effect of the westerly winds, the temperate monsoons and the cyclonic effect. So these are some of the major factors that affect the rainfall. As we talked about, the rainfall in summers and winters are attributed to different reasons in this area. Now, as you move poleward and southward, you have the rainfall that decreases. Now, that is due to different reasons. In the north, what happens is the air is unable to hold the moisture, and therefore, as you move north, the rainfall would decrease. As you move south, you have semi-arid steppe region that is seen. So the southern boundaries and the northern boundaries would have very less rainfall as compared to the central regions. This region does not have a permanent snow field, as you can see in the Alps and Himalayas. Now why it is so? As we said, Alps and Himalayas, you have altitudinal concept that works, that's due to the height of the mountains. However, here there cannot be permanent snow fields because you have the spring and the summers, and what happens during the spring and the summers is melting, and during that melting what would happen, the rivers that were frozen would have the water level that would change and thawing that would take place. So you would have kind of seasonal floods that could be seen again in this region. Now since this region is snow covered, what are the benefits? First is, snow is a poor conductor of heat. So what would happen is, it would protect the ground from the extreme weather temperatures and also the extreme cold above that region. It would also provide moisture when the snow begins to melt in the spring season. So two important things to note, it does not have permanent snow fields. Again I repeat, the reason is because of the melting of the rivers during that time of spring and summer, and you would have moisture during that time, so thawing would take place. Now again an important phenomena, when the ground is plowed, you have the podzolic soil that is found in this region and which is predominantly acidic. So the soil is improved during this time and a minor agriculture could be seen in this region. Coming on to the vegetation, as we said, conifers is the primary vegetation that is seen in this region. Now conifers would vary based on the height. In the north you would have pine. In the south, you would have larch that would be seen. So those are the different varieties. Now, from the conifers, you predominantly get softwood. Of this softwood, 1/4 of the softwood is used as fuel. Most of the wood that is used for the purpose of fuel comes from hardwood. So 3/4 of the fuel consumption comes from hardwood. Only 1/4 goes from softwood. Again, softwood, you have majority of that goes into paper industry, you have matches industry, you have pulp industry and so on. So industrial use, basically formation of resins. So all those you have softwood that is required. The highest production of the softwood is seen in Russia. Then you have the production of softwood is less in America as compared to Canada. And in the Fennoscandian countries, that is Finland, Norway and Sweden, together these three countries we call them as Fennoscandian countries. So you have high softwood production there. Again, there is difference between the pulp production and the paper production. So wood pulp you have can be obtained from both mechanical processes or chemical processes. Either of this wood pulp, you have America that leads in the production. However, when it comes to paper, the newsprint, you have Canada that leads the production. So difference between pulp and paper is here. So you have pulp production highest in America. However, newsprint or paper production highest in Canada. As we said, the Siberian belt is known as Taiga belt, and it is the biggest source of softwood, the temperate softwood that could be seen. Again, an interesting feature for the softwoods here is they occur in homogeneous strand, that means they occur in similar strand. So all the pine trees would occur together. What would be the best benefit of this? The best benefit would be, since all of the trees are occurring together and all of them are similar, their commercial exploitation becomes very easy. So you have lumbering that is commonly seen in this region. Now, as we said, there are four common species that are seen for the conifers. The first is pine, you have larch, spur and fir. Now, pines, fir and spur are found in the northern regions, and larch is found somewhere in the southern regions. In the pine, you have white pine, red pine, scot pine, jack pine and lodgepole pine. However, in fir, you have two common varieties, which is known as Douglas fir and balsam fir, that is seen. As we said, conifers are straight trees, very tall, up to 100 feet, and as you move north, they are widely spaced. So they occur close by in the Siberian region, but as you move towards the polar regions, you would see them far apart. So as you move north, the density, we can say, for the conifers decreases. Again, conifers are unique because they have 2 years of fructification cycle. What happens during the first year is the seed is pollinated, and in the second year you have the dispersal of the seeds that occur. Now on the pine trees you have cones that are seen. Now these cones, this is an example of a male cone and a female cone. We'll talk about this more in the section on biology, gymnosperm. So basically, conifers first of all are gymnosperms. So the seeds that could be seen are obvious, they are not within the fruit. Now what happens is pollination is done mainly by the wind. Now this pollinates onto the female, this is sticky, and you have on the top of this, you would have the seeds that are seen, and these seeds could be in the form of pine nuts that could be seen, which is also known as chilgoza in Hindi. So these pines are the roasted pines. Now what happens is, in reality you have these which lie over here, and these pines artificially they are heated and this explodes, and you have the seeds that come out from the pine tree. So you have the coniferous that could be seen. Now we have given this detailed diagram for the same cone which is seen on a pine tree. Now on this cone you can see you have the seeds that lie here, and these seeds, again you have the seeds that could be seen here, these dark colored seeds within this cone, and you have the finally the pine nuts, which are also known as chilgoza, are seen on this. As we said, there is no annual replacement for the new leaves that occur, as in the deciduous years and deciduous trees, and in this conifers the same leaves remain for at least 5 years. The food is stored in the trunk or the bark of the tree. Now this bark is protected from the cold because it is thick, and so what happens is two features. The bark is thick, you have food within this bark. The tree is conical in shape, so all the snow that is falling would go off. It would not be stored on the tree, or it would not remain on the tree, and it would wipe off. Most of the trees, most of the leaves are needle shaped. There are two benefits of this needle shaped leaves. First is it reduces the transpiration, and second is it can shield itself from the strong wind, the blizzards and the buran, what we call the blizzards in Canada and the burans in Europe. So they can protect themselves from this high speed winds, and therefore you have these winds. So this is an example of a conifer trees. As we said, the leaves are small, needle shaped and leathery. Whenever you have coniferous trees that are seen, you have very little undergrowth that is seen. Now this is one of the reasons, because for this is the absence of the direct sunlight, since you have huge trees that are standing there, the sunlight is obstructed and you do not have ample sunlight for the underground vegetation that could be seen. Only in the summers, where you have short agricultural season, you can see those. Conifers, as we said, are also common in the mountain areas. Now, what happens on a very steep slope? Now, if this is the mountain, for example, you can have the coniferous. While if this is a kind of very vertical mountain that is seen, what would happen? The conifers would not be able to survive on this because the soil is constantly being eroded, and since the soil is immature here, you cannot have a kind of coniferous trees that could be seen on a very steep mountain slope. The next is the economic development in the areas of Siberian region. Now, as we said, the most common activity here is lumbering, because the trees are commonly seen and the commercial exploitation becomes very easy. Agriculture is very less. Only agriculture that could be seen is in the form of potatoes, in the root crops, and you have barley, oat and rye, mainly the coarse grains that are seen. Most of the people live here a life of hunters and nomads. So you have Somaites and Yakuts in Siberia, and in Canada again you have hunting, fishing and trapping that is commonly seen. Now, what is trapping? Most of the animals here are fur bearing. Now, this fur is used for wool, this fur is used for industrial purpose, so for making handbags and other furnitures. So what happens is, there are numerous fur bearing animals which are known as muskrat, ermine, mink and silver fox. We have some of the examples here. So you have the silver fox. Now, this is very furry, so you have fur that is utilized. Similarly, you have ermine, you have muskrat, and then you have mink. All of these are furry animals, and you have furs that are used for various industries and wool production. Then you have in Siberia, you have squirrels, otters, bears, sables, lynx and fox. All of these are fur bearing and they commercially utilize the fur from these animals. When it is cold at its peak, the amount of the fur on the body of the animals increases. After the winters have gone, you have these animals, the fur is taken off, and these fur that is obtained from the Siberian region is known for its quality and high price. Again, in Canada, what happens is, nowadays with technology, you have automatic rifles that are available, and the hunters and the trappers, they live in log cabins. They do not go into the open forest, they live in the log cabins, and from the log cabins, they use automatic rifles to shoot the animals. And therefore, there is a kind of regular supply of furs, which is also known as fur farms. Now, this has been, this log cabin idea has replaced the traditional way of hunting the wild animals in Siberia. Lumbering, as we said, that's cutting of the trees for the wood pulp and the paper industry, mainly the newsprint industry. As we said, you have logging that take place, and again from the byproduct of this timber, you have chemically processed articles, mainly from the rayon, paints, dyes and resins that are used. Now, these mainly occurs in the winter. Why? First of all, during the winters, the sap that oozes from the tree stops. So you have a coniferous and I am cutting it. So if whatever sap or liquid is coming from the tree, that ceases during the winter months. So winters is considered the best time for lumbering. Again, during the winters, what happens? The field is snow covered. So it's very easy to drag them or roll them downhill or downstream, and you would have the sawmills there which would be using hydroelectric power for the sawmill industry, and you would have these logs that would be taken to the downstream region with a very easy haulage during the winter months. Now, again, the northern sea route links between the Murmansk and Vladivostok via the Arctic Ocean is one of the major areas for lumbering. So with this, we cover the chapter 23 of Goh Cheng Leong. We are just remained with two chapters in the climatic regions section. So we would be covering that as early as possible. Stay tuned for our lectures. Have a good day ahead.